in Arizona State's final Pac-12 conference opener in a game where they were the heaviest home underdog in program history. ASU falls short to number 5 USC 42-28. Nick Borgia, Devil's Digest, alongside our publisher Hode Urbino. And Hode, I think the end result of this game was what people were expecting, but I think the way that the Sun Devils and the Trojans got there might not be what people were expecting. I mean, this game was a 3-point game in the third quarter. It was close.
Yeah, absolutely, Nick. And I think that more than anything else, ASU fans wanted to see this team have a pulse after a 29 shutout loss at home to Fresno State. And in that sense, I think the mission definitely accomplished. ASU is going on the road for the first time next week at Cal. Cal's not a juggernaut by any means, but you would want it to have some kind of confidence, be in a better state of mind going in on the road for the first time. And I think after tonight, there are definitely are a lot of positives to take away from this game. And sure, if you had some action on this game and you thought that ASU, even though after a horrible performance to Fresno State, was still able to cover a ridiculous 5-touchdown line in USC's favor, well, I think you're also leaving the stadium with a little smile on your face. But really, all jokes aside, Nick, I thought that there definitely are a lot of positives to take away from this game from Arizona State, and I think that the fan base was absolutely dismayed after last week, and what happened against Fresno State is definitely maybe looking at this team in a different light, in a different perspective. And again, to me, aside from the obvious, having an upset win against the number 5 team in the nation, you wanted to have something to really hang your hat on, and I thought that the Sun Devils did provide that in spades tonight.
Well, let's look at this ASU offense. The bright side, they scored some points this game. Kenny Dillingham calling plays showed a lot of creativity, a really different look to this offense. Got to be exciting for the team and fans alike. On the downside, a couple turnovers, a lot of sacks for quarterback Drew Pine that did kill some momentum that prevented the Sun Devils from really getting back in the game.
Yeah, let's get the bad news out of the way, Nick. And like I said, really a horrible performance for Drew Pine, I thought. And look, last week against Fresno State, as we know, he had 4 turnovers, 2 interceptions, 2 some sack fumbles. And I thought that, okay, he did have a lot of rust to knock off. As you remember, he did have a hamstring tear back on August 12th during the Camp T scrimmage. So in his first full action of the year, maybe it was unreasonable to think that Pine would hit the ground running and have an error-free game. And maybe also, just like a lot of players in any sport, really, for that matter, just needed to have that horrible game, get out of their system, and everything from here on out could be an upward trajectory. But when you look at Pine's performance, Nick, I thought it really held Arizona State back. When you play a team like USC, you have to have a good number of explosive plays in the passing game. That simply did not happen. And if it did happen, it happened courtesy of Cam Scadaboo, which I'll get in a second. But when you look at Drew Pine's stats, I mean, really, you know, nothing to write home about. 21 of 36, 221 yards, 2 touchdown passes, 1 interception. He was sacked 8 times. And going into this game, Nick, I made mention that Drew Pine needs to get rid of the ball in 3 seconds or less. And in many of those sacks, that was not the case at all. And I think that really just demoralized the offense that much that they could not get anything going with Drew Pine behind center. Now, the good news is Cam Scadaboo played out of his mind. I mean, to say it was a breakout game, I think would be a gross understatement for the newcomer running back, a transfer from Sacramento State and FCS program. What did Scadaboo not do tonight? He had over 100 all-purpose yards, had a receiving touchdown, had a rushing touchdown, actually faked a punt and threw a fourth down pass to Badger, something that Scadaboo, to his credit, did say it was an improvised play. And Nick, we were there all week in practice. We never saw it in practice, so we take his word for it. It really was an improvised play, but everything was going well for Scadaboo, and I think it was definitely a thorn in the side for USC. I mean, I heard their fans aren't happy at all with the way their defense played, and I think Scadaboo is definitely one big reason for that. Scadaboo also had a 53-yard punt. I mean, just absolutely just ridiculous performance, but just very encouraging to see that, again, this offense was flat line last week, and to see somebody like Scadaboo just really revive it, and like you said, a lot of it is because of Kenny Dillingham's creative play calling. And again, even when the creative play calling was not there, Scadaboo's improvisation was there. I thought Elijah Badger, also another player that definitely had his best game of the year, and I know that the bar is pretty low up until now, but also had over 100 all-purpose yards, did also well with kickoff return, did have a receiving touchdown. So when you have those two players, you know, playing at a high level, if he does have a quarterback, any quarterback on the roster, that can play better than Pine, to be more effective, to really avoid the sacks, avoid the turnovers, this ASU offense can really support the great effort by the defense, which we'll talk about in a minute. So, you know, bottom line, Kenny Dillingham calling plays tonight paid off, I think, in spades. Cam Scadabo and Elijah Badger, and also say Jalen Conyers at times, really did come to life with this new approach by the ASU offense. I mean, sure, they didn't change any philosophies, and sure, they used plays already in the playbook. It wasn't like they worked on something just a few days and just put it on display tonight. But nonetheless, there's a lot to be encouraged about this ASU offense going forward.
Yeah, I have to agree. A step in the right direction for sure. The USC defense is not an easy defense to play. So the ASU offense being able to put up 28 after last week's 0 points, definitely encouraging. But let's talk about the ASU defense now. In a similar fashion to last week, got put in a couple tough spots with the turnovers, having to face Caleb Williams in the USC offense, who were averaging 59 points coming into the game. ASU able to hold them to 42. What was your reaction to the defensive performance overall, though, Hode?
Yeah, look, I honestly thought that the USC offense wasn't going to have issues against the ASU defense. We know that this ASU defense coming into this game was ranked 34th in the nation in total defense, and I think it showed. I think they gave the USC offense a lot of problems. I mean, I don't know if there's any game even last year, let alone this year, that we saw this USC offense were just really out of sorts. I mean, a lot of confusion in the second half. They took timeouts way earlier than probably they ever did in the last, you know, not only year and a half, but maybe even, I would say, two, 3 years. I think they really did a great job confusing the Trojans. Now, look, I mean, they just have absolute ridiculous skilled players like running back Marshawn Lloyd, like wide receiver Brendan Rice. I mean, when those guys get in open space or just in a foot race with a defender, it really is a battle that does go in their favor more often than not. But the fact that they had 535 total yards and only have 42 points to show for it, I think tells you a lot about what the ASU defense was able to accomplish. So if you're an ASU fan, you definitely tip your hat off to Brian Ward, the defensive coordinator. I thought he had a great scheme to it, you know, tonight. And, you know, I think that's a running theme of the whole night, especially in the second half, is that this defense deserved better than the offensive effort that ASU had. And it's just a real shame that this ASU defense could not have been rewarded with an upset win, because they were definitely worth an upset win. I just think that the down the stretch, you know, they just really buckled under the pressure, because again, the ASU offense really did nothing to support them, you know, whatsoever. But again, if you're just looking for some you know, ray of hope, looking for, you know, to really hang your head on, I feel that the fact that this ASU defense did play well against Fresno State, but obviously with the offense being absolutely anemic, there was no chance of a win. And tonight, this ASU defense really kept USC for, I would say, even over 3.5 quarters at arm's length at all times. So this really is a special group. If the offense can just support it, and it really needs to start next week against Cal, I think that this ASU team can maybe surprise and really, I guess, defeat all the bleak predictions that really hover around this team after the first weeks of play. So ASU defense to me really played outstanding, and I think that they probably showed the blueprint for a lot of future USC opponents on how to effectively attack this USC offense. Again, great performance by the Sun Devils on this side of the ball.
Well, with the loss, they moved to 0-1 in Pac-12 play, 1-3 overall on the season. And as you mentioned, they got Cal next week. That's their first road game of the season. Cal, not quite the caliber of number 5 USC. So based on what you saw out there tonight, what do you think needs to be the focus for ASU as they practice this week and prepare for their first road game against a lesser opponent?
Well, look, I'm going to flat out say it. I really hope that on offense, they better hope that Trent Borgay is healthy, because we didn't see anything promising from Pine. Definitely not last week against Fresno State, but not even this week against USC. And for me, it's hard to see ASU winning this game if Trent Borgay is not going to be the starting quarterback next week. I'm told there's a good chance that it can happen. We'll see what's going to transpire in practice this week. But I just think, again, just the offense overall, and especially players like Cam Scadabu, Elijah Badger, tight end Jalen Conyers, they're just right now, they finally have confidence on their side. The way they played against USC, now they know that going into Cal, they just feel more more confident in their abilities. You know, Kenny Dillingham exactly provided the shot in the arm that this offense needed with his creative play calling. And I just feel like the offense has really been brought to life tonight. I mean, and I know that maybe I sound repeating myself, but it's just one of those points that really cannot be overstated, especially when you not only score 0 points last week, but you were scoreless in the last six quarters dating back to the Oklahoma State contest in week two. And as far as the ASU defense, I mean, they definitely know that the offensive firepower they're going to face with Cal is going to be at a much lesser caliber than what they face against USC. So that's another aspect of this ASU team that really has a lot of confidence going into that Cal game. So again, this was a game that had to give you some kind of ray of hope, and I think it provided it both of the offense, both of the defense. Sure, there's some things to tweak on both sides of the ball, but overall, I think if you're an ASU fan, you feel much better about your team right now, even after a Pac-12 loss, than you did this time last week against Fresno State.
All right, Hode. Well, thank you so much, as always, for your insight. We'll be making our first road trip of the year, going to Cal, so you know what that means. Keep it locked in at DevilsDigest.com. Drop a follow at DevilsDigest on Twitter for all the coverage surrounding the team as they prepare for Cal. For Hode Urbino, my name's Nick Borgia. We thank you so much for tuning in, and we will see you next time.